take my lips and speak through them. Take our minds and think through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire with love for you. Amen. Bishop Jennifer, Jeff, Aaron, Ray, Mom and Dad, clergy of the diocese, wardens, vestry, the SALT leadership team, members of the parish, visitors, what a joy and honor it is to be here with you all tonight. Once again, the common lectionary and the church calendar have said to me clearly, God speaking. When Debbie called to tell me the date of this celebration and asked me to preach, I was very humbled and honored and a little awed of responsibility. She said St. Albans would be having a harvest celebration on the feast day of St. Sergius of Zagors. After we ended our call, the richness of what was ahead was just filling my mind. What better imagery for the hard work of this parish that it's been involved in and continues in the harvest, with this tangible example of the garden right here on the corner of Emerson for all the city to see. My focus was already on this rich imagery of the harvest, but the name Zagors kept running through my mind pretty intensely. Then suddenly, I realized. I hurried to my study, and I picked up a small black travel diary from the bookshelf, and I was transported back to another September in 1989. As part of my doctoral program in psychology, I was a member of a demonstration group introducing Gestalt therapy to the Soviet Union, which had previously known only a medical model of mental health treatment, including radical hospitalizations and the not always kind techniques that go with that. We were pilgrims and we were on a mission. We arrived at Moscow at night after a long, long flight. We had transferred to the Russian carrier Aeroflot in Finland, which involved a long, unexplained wait and anxiety-producing strangeness. Having finally landed in Moscow, we were sort of huddled together. It was a cold night, waiting to clear customs and immigration. All of a sudden, I heard my name called in very broken English. I was handed my passport and my papers by a very stern-faced, uniformed immigration officer who silently pointed me down a long concrete path that was bordered on each side by barbed wire. I remember looking over my shoulder at my colleagues and willing my feet to move. At the end of the path, I stood alone on Russian soil, on the other side of the Iron Curtain. Having been raised in a culture of fear regarding all things Russian, the wait for my colleagues to join me seemed interminable. I had chosen this pilgrimage. I wanted engagement with the Russian people, but at that moment, the whole thing didn't seem like such a great idea. Anxiety had temporarily erased even promised highlights of our trip from my mind. We were pilgrims, yes, but arriving at a spiritual destination in Zagors was the last thing I wanted. A bed, a hot shower, and my friends were paramount. There was no way to know on that dark night that by the time we arrived at that important site, the monastery at Zagors, some 2 weeks later, we would have forged amazing relationships in Moscow, in Vilnius, Lithuania, and in Leningrad. We would have drunk an amazing number of vodka toasts proclaiming friendship, and were feeling sad to begin to think of going home and leaving our new friends behind. I really hadn't focused on the Zagors part of my journey for a long time, although watercolors in my home remind me daily of this life-changing trip. Those watercolors were purchased from student street artists who were hungry for American dollars. And so the exchange went like this. I put my $20 $50 bills in a rolled-up newspaper under my arm. They put their art in a rolled-up newspaper under their arms, and we met under the bridge. Later, my foolishness was challenged, but I have the artwork. During my years as transition officer for the Diocese of Lexington, I often called on that visceral memory of that Moscow night when working with congregations in a search process. A search process is a special kind of pilgrimage in the life of a congregation. Both congregation and priests enter into the process with excitement and hope, more anticipation than trepidation. But for all that excitement and all that anticipation, both are leaving the familiar, the known, and walking a long walk into a basically unknown situation, carrying unstated expectations, old loyalties, diverse experiences and trainings, many hopes and dreams. As in any new engagement, there are moments the whole thing doesn't seem like such a great idea. And since, in clergy call, there is an expectation that God has a major role in the proceedings, there are often shock moments when both the callers and the call want to bring up headquarters and say, "Are you serious? Are you there?" And most often, there are many hills to climb and challenges to face before arriving at one's own Zagors, the sacred site or spiritual culmination of any pilgrimage. There was a bit of a reminder for me of the arrival in Moscow and my first visit to St. Albans, which is about a year ago, when we first began our work together here. Over the years, a revolving door of clergy had led to hard-working laity keeping the doors open and ministries alive, but also to struggles with the diocese and confusion about responsibilities and roles when a rector is actually in place. There was little trust and lots of splintering. Now, like most churches I'm called to work with, leadership always assures me that they are a loving, friendly church. And the truth is generally more along the lines, by the time I arrive, of some groups in isolation in a fragmented system. More than once in the early days of our work, we spoke of our call to be a model for a broken world, not to mirror its brokenness. Together, numerous members of this congregation did the hard work of telling the truthful history of this congregation, telling their different experiences, warts, family secrets, and all, in order to find patterns that pointed to the work that we needed to do to move forward. We paid special attention to the model of Bishop Tutu's work with the Truth and Reconciliation in South Africa after apartheid, as he reminded his people that they could experience the same thing, the same situation, and be impacted differently because of their life stories, and reminded them that they are not called to defend their own truth or to try to change another person's mind, but simply to honor each story. And so we tried to do. There were many times when the feeling of being in a strange land was with us, confronting the unknown or unacknowledged in ourselves and in others. There were resistances and some doubts, and sometimes tensions and tempers of flare. But each time I came around the corner onto Emerson and turned into the church parking lot, the garden and the gardeners seemed to whisper a message of hope. This was a place that knew about planting, about tending, about watering, and that there could be no growth without lots of weeding, continual weeding, and plenty of fertilizing. One of the lessons appointed for this feast day of St. Sergius is Luke chapter 8, which you just heard read, verses 16 to 21. It's the familiar parable I know you know well regarding see it, not hiding it. And of course, earlier in chapter 8, we have the parable of the seed, which can fall upon rock or thorns as well as upon good solid soil. Now, if we consider all this at a literal level, all of us would say, well, of course, I wouldn't light a lamp to hide that light. The whole purpose of lighting a lamp is to illuminate something, shine a light on darkness. Likewise, who would allow seeds to fall on rock or amid thorns rather than good soil and then expect something good to grow? Scripture says, and some seeds fell on good ground and sprung up and bear fruit 100-fold. In the language of parables, the lamp and the seed represent Jesus and the Word. The fruit born 100-fold. Those who not only hear that word, but put it into practice. The gospel message was not meant to be hidden. Invisible Christian is a contradiction in terms. However, in the language of our work together, destructive behaviors, hurtful behaviors among church members toward each other, wounds left unattended and festering, rumors, bitterness, triangulation, all of these things can indeed cloak the Spirit of Jesus until that Spirit is invisible, unable to be seen or experienced by each other or by a hurting world. In 1989, as our little group of weary pilgrims and our hosts finally approached Zagorsk, we were laughing and talking together like old friends. In these short weeks, we had experienced so much together, and the uncertainty and fear of that first long walk toward Russian soil had been replaced by a warmth and a willingness to do the hard work of relationships, not just on this adventure, but for the long haul. Our gesture toward healing a hurting world. This is the kind of journey this parish has taken, and tonight celebrates the first fruits of a new harvest season of many to come. A spirit of genuine love and laughter permeate this place. A spirit forged in the freedom of honesty, directness, and yes, both laughter and tears, and a call far greater than self. No longer strangers of unknown expectations to each other, but discernment that God has more work for you to do together. You have called Reverend Debbie to be your rector, and she has said yes. In the entryway, statements of the work you have done and now continue hang on either side of the cross. A promise to all who come here of what you are about in God's name. And so tonight we celebrate this first harvest of the hard work in which this wonderful parish has invested and continues to invest. As you have lovingly, devotedly tended your physical garden in good weather and bad, you have committed yourselves to devotedly, lovingly, doing the hard work of putting His Word into practice, illuminating hope for a world that has never needed it more. You have determined to make the gospel visible, to hold the light high so that others may see. And as if to put an exclamation mark on this night and where you are heading in the future, at the end of the reading about St. Sergius of Zagorsk, so there can be no doubt in any mind that God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit calls all to be like theirs, in a long tradition of those who hold the light for those who walk in darkness. We're reminded that this gentle, mystical St. Sergius, born in the year 1314, was even then eager that his long-ago monks serve the needs of their neighbors, reach out to their hurting world. The short description of St. Sergius ends with these words. Sergius' name is familiar to anger.